Good morning. The long hot spell here in Zurich has finally ended. It's now raining, and it means it's finally cool enough that I can actually stream some more game development. If you were around for the previous stream, I actually had to stop doing streaming after about half an hour because it was too hot and was no longer making any sense. I've done some development since. I'm going to show you what I've been up to, and then we're going to dive into doing some more things to land ships. And here's some background music. There we go. So this is one leg this time. It's from a really nice website. It has a whole bunch of open music available. It's called muzopen.org. Just going to show you the website. There we go. So yeah, muzopen.org, and it has a whole bunch of royalty-free, actually free music, mostly classical instrumental stuff. But you can actually use that without being eaten by the copyright weasels. Okay, so double checking OBS isn't set up wrong. No, I think that should be fine. Yep, I hope I'm not clipping too badly. Actually, speak a bit more softly, I think. Let me know if you do experience any audio issues or otherwise. And assuming not, we're going to get started. Okay, so what I've been up to? Basically, I've been improving the behavior of legs. So they now stand on other land ships rather than just kind of going through them. They try to find alternate places to put the foot down if the standard place isn't available. And they have a bunch of new kind of constraints to the way that they move, which makes them move more naturally. I'll show you what that looks like now. Oh yeah, and the other thing is that the speed of the leg animation is now dependent on the movement speed of the land ship, which means that they can take bigger strides as well without it looking stupid, and just looks a lot better. Okay, so here, let's put in a land ship, a good old, let's put in the grasshopper, I guess, the big one. There we go. So as you can see, it now takes bigger steps. And gets a little bit less confused when traveling over rough terrain. And it can stand on top of buildings. And trample them, in fact. So there we go. You can now just trample enemy buildings to death. There we go. Okay, so as you can see, that now works pretty nicely. So let's see what's up next on the to-do list, basically. Okay. Okay, so change move command so it tracks expected Y position. Because right now, when we tell a land ship to move, we can place the new location of it anywhere we want. And that's true on the X axis, but of course, on the Y axis, it kind of knows where it's going to end up at. So it would be good to constrain the Y position of that box to be, based on where it assumes the ship will end up at. So let's do that first. And that's basically in move. That's in move command tool. So that's the tool that gets activated when you tell a ship to move. Okay, so that's how we derive the y coordinate, and now we just have to be a bit cleverer yet about how we derive this. So okay, and now of course we need to do some cleverness, where we go if it's on the ground, then we need to track the actual ground. So if us.selectchip.onGround, then we want to make the Y position track where it would actually end up vertically, and to figure out where that would be, I think we can use place. You can have a look at what place ship tool does. There we go. Pretty much this. Need to pass in the expected X position. There we go. So now it, if we're trying to move something that's ground based, it should now set the Y coordinate of where it displays the box and where it actually tells it to move to be based on the ground. Which isn't quite correct yet, because he needed to be based on more than the ground, actually. He needed to be based on, well, anything at all, really. Other ships, floating rocks. But that's a start, you know. Okay. So now if we tell it to move, you can see the vertical position of that white box tracks the ground and actually gives a sane estimate of where it's going to end up at. So that's good. But note they get it wrong here, right? Fatelica that way. Well, okay, it tries to climb and fails, to be fair. Nice try. So an ideal world would actually look at the vertical position of everything, even other ships. But I don't think it's so important right now. We'll just leave it at that. So we're going to commit this to Git and work on something else. Excellent. Now I'm just going to see if I can't convince my iPad to actually start up. No, it just doesn't. Never mind. This is somewhat frustrating because it means I can't actually see if anyone's talking on the chat. But I hope you're all listening in and enjoying this, or listening to it in a time-shifted fashion. And next stream, I will hopefully have an operational iPad that will actually work and let me see the stream chat. For now, let's press on. Okay, so the next two things are both fun. We've got trying to stomp troops. I haven't actually tried out what happens if you just have some ground troops standing around, how they interact with feet. I actually just don't know. And then there's a whole lot of graphic stuff that we need to do. So my suggestion is that we're going to leave the graphic stuff aside for now, plonk that down a bit, work on that later. And what we're going to do for the remainder of this stream is we're basically going to do more development. And then later on today, I will probably do a second stream where I do graphics. I'm trying to keep these streams at like about an hour of length, because I think that's probably a good amount of time for people to actually be bothered watching it. You probably don't want to marathon a 3-hour thing. And frankly, if I do 3 hours in one go, then I'm useless for the rest of the day. But let's get started then and troop stomping. Okay, so the easiest way of doing this is to just plain hack something in that adds some troops to the combat. So let's just try to do that. Just going to say, if we have a combat and we have a side, right, the side has troops, yeah. And we're just going to create some like automatically. Ta-da! Okay, and wants to know which chip it's in? None. Wants to know which tile it's in? None. And we'll make it, yeah, a guard. Why not? Whatever. Just see that we can actually init this. Okay, good, that doesn't crash out if we initialize it with no ship and no tile. Then cm.x equals and the Y position, which is going to say, is going to be 100 pixels above ground level, which will hopefully make them mostly materialize outside of any rocks, but still low down enough that they won't die from the fall. Okay, let's just see what happens there. That might crash out, because I might need to set some values on these newly created troops for them not to have some kind of attack, but it might work. And yeah, I just literally want some guys standing on the ground so I can trample them and see if that works. I mean, ideally, it will just work out, and what happens is I can stand on them and they die horribly, right? But who knows? Right now, I can't actually see them. So, I'm not convinced. No, I'm not at all convinced. Okay. So that didn't work particularly well. Oh. It didn't. Sorry for that, Raspberry. It didn't work because I never added the crewman I made to the troops, right? It's more my favorite. Do some work and then lovingly throw away the result to wonder why nothing works. Oh yeah, there we go. So now we have a whole bunch of crewmen that has spontaneously materialized in midair, and we can see what happens to them. Okay, so they've all fallen down, and now they're just standing there. So this is like the other major thing that really needs doing for Early Access 7, is that right now when crew are on the ground, they are completely helpless. Like, they have no logic in them at all for being able to move across the ground or do anything. So they're just standing there, and they're like twitching, even the animation's not right. So let's see if we can put them out of their misery. I have no idea if this will work. No, they remain irritatingly alive. Okay, so yeah, this is bad. Like, what I would like to see... Okay, some of them are now hanging on to the ship, which is sort of cool. Yeah, so like... Yeah, basically nothing happens. What I would like to see is them to... I would like them to die horribly from the collisions. So, let's think about that. Let's look at foot. So, okay, so... The foot is technically willing to collide with... with the crewman. So I'm just going to do a little check if B2 instance of crewman. Ah, of course it's not a body, right? Crewmen are not bodies, they're just physics rects. So of course they will not actually collide meaningfully. So, for purposes of feet and feet alone, they sort of want to be bodies. Like, the idea is that, like, general crewmen can hold on to the side of ships and go across, like, rocks and so on. But they should be just on the same kind of level of... the same kind of virtual Z position as feet. Purely because that's fun and then we can stomp them. We probably want to do something that we only ever stomp enemy ones as well. That would be polite. So let's just look into how that might work. So physics... This is a concept of a physics rect here. And that's like a simplified version of a body. It doesn't have a mass and doesn't have a whole bunch of things. There we go. Yeah, and like Crewman is a physics fact and so on. Oh, my pad's booted up. Okay, there's a special troop physics behavior which we might have to look into. We probably really do. Okay, iPad booting. Okay, so from now on I'm actually able to monitor the chat. So if you do have any questions about the game development, you can now ask me them on the Twitch chat and I might actually see them and answer them. Oh yes, hello peeps. I see we have some viewers. Hello. Oh yes, now it's the important time wherein I try to pronounce everyone's names and fail. Hi Islidius, hi Malam 518, hi Leichte Kavallerie, that one's easy, that one's German, and hi Luca Cuckoo. Nice of you all to be watching. Okay, so we are doing awful things that happen to troops for $500. Okay, so here's basically a whole bunch of slightly gnarly logic for going over stuff and saying, well, what happens? What happens to the physics of troops? And here we are literally, we're just going over each side, we're going over each crewman, and then we're going over each body. And we're saying, if we're not already holding on to it, and if it's actually intersecting, and if it collides, if it furthermore believes that it actually collides with us, then some stuff happens. So we could just do squashy. Okay, so we're going to see. Hi. We're going to see if that little condition we put in, the little, let's say, squashy condition, actually gets called when we step on crew members. Because if that does get called, then we can kind of move on from there and figure out the correct behavior for them dying horribly. Oh dear. No, that didn't work. Okay. Yeah, so some of them died. And we already have a squashy being emitted. Yeah, because they're already standing on some of them. Awesome, so that fundamentally works. Nice. But then I guess the point is basically that the collision speed isn't all that big. So it's just going to introduce an extra awful, horrible, horrible rule where essentially we're putting in that land ships are going to intentionally step on enemy soldiers. So if B is instance of foot, and as a foot, B dot ship, so if the ship and not K Okay, there we go. So we're going default. So now I'm just failing a Java. There we go. Right, so we go, dear foot, what ship are you attached to? Is it a nice ship? Is it a ship that likes me? If it's not a nice ship, then, well, oops. I'm just going to set damage to something gruesome like 10. So, yeah, that's just going to kill them. So we can stamp on our friendlies, but we can't stamp on our enemies. And just to illustrate this, we just make it... God, how do we do this best? There. There's some default names, and I'm just going to hack in that, like, our guys have a different uniform than the enemy, so we can visually see that it actually works. Yeah, they're just called you and enemy, so name dot equals you. So if they're me, then they're guards, otherwise they're, say, grenadiers, nice and red. So what should now happen is that all of the guards should be just fine. Mostly fine. Theoretically speaking, the normal collision logic is still in there, so if you get a really rapidly moving foot, they might take damage, and that's actually fine. I mean, if the foot's moving really fast, then maybe they can't jump out of the way in the on time, so that's alright. But if it's an enemy foot, well, then they're going to be stamped on specifically. Okay, so here they are, half guards, half grenadiers. Let's move over to them. Oh yes, oh yes! Stampy, stampy, oh look at that. That was fun. They should... Why don't they scream when they die? Okay, that's a major bug on my part. I apologize profoundly at the lack of death screams. I mean, look at that. They're not screaming when they die. But hey, it works, right? We made it work. It's they can now squash enemy troops. Okay, let's be honest, right? The scream's not enough. We really need a kind of crunkle, squelch, squoosh sound for like maximum brutality. So yeah, let's we can do that. awesome. So fundamentally squashing like that now works. Probably have to end up doing the same thing with wheels, but we'll get to that when we go back to wheels in a little bit. Ooh, this is complaining. Never mind. Okay, so that works. Now we want to take out this logic, because obviously we don't actually want to randomly spawn troops yet. But I'm going to leave it in for debugging purposes. But that works. So that was like 3 lines to get that whole stamping troops thing to work, which is very satisfying. Oh yeah, by the way, let me know about the volume of the background music. If it's too quiet or too loud, I can adjust it. So yeah. Okay, stomping troops now works. So I'm gonna put in a whole thing about like stomping sounds. Crewman death sounds. And walking particles. So someone, oh dear, was on the forum or on the stream or something, suggested that like what should happen is that if you like walking on in a snowy environment, for example, you should get like puffs of snow and snow stuck to the feet and so on. And I really like that. I think it will be a nice little detail. So that's definitely something I want to put in. Speaking of forums, if you want to talk about the game, there are some reasonably lively forums, which are here. Airships.zarkon.com, no, the HTTPS, otherwise it doesn't work, because I messed something up. I'm just going to actually put that somewhere. So I'm being stupid. Being stupid because something. Text, yeah. Link. I'm gonna use Fledermaus because Fledermaus is the best font. Yeah, something like that, huh? Yeah, let's put it in the top left, huh? Just make it a little bit bigger. There we go. So now you can, if you know where to go if you want to talk to people about the game. Right. So, what we're going to do next is, well, next is going to be some slightly boring things. Basically, we've got what we've got left in terms of things are fixes. The AI isn't super capable of dealing with the idea of having Landship yet, so that's something that needs fixing. If nothing else, Landship AI is actually sort of simpler because there are far fewer possible positions for it to consider. AI right now is eating up like 20% of CPU time at least. If you have a big fight, sometimes like more like 50. Just because it has to constantly recalculate all kind, like the grid of plausible positions to move each ship, and that's really expensive. And with the land ship, of course, it's not really a grid, it's more line, because I mean it's just going to move on one axis, so land ships are actually going to be like an order of magnitude or two cheaper in terms of AI costs. That should actually, make it harvest those benefits. Check collision behavior, ship ship and ship ground still makes sense. So one of the things I've been doing is getting the whole thing to work where feet can now stamp ground things in kind of the right way. So a foot will happily squash a say a bush, but won't just go through soil like butter. And it basically, the reason why I think like last time you saw the stream, this stuff wasn't working properly, and this basically just entailed a whole lot of changing around of values to make them behave better for that. And now this is kind of a danger, because it means that, well, maybe I've made that work and everything else breaks. So I need to check, like, do ship on ship collisions have, like, do the right amount of damage? Like, it might be now that, like, if two ships vaguely brush against each other, they explode, or if they, like, get at each other at full speed, they just sort of bounce off. So it's possible I need to change some of the behaviors there. Then we've got the vibrating behavior, which you might have seen if you've been watching the stream, that sometimes a landship just gets into this thing where it vibrates back and forth by one pixel. Be very nice to clean that up, just because it looks bad. And finally, there's a whole bunch of red text you can see in the menus and so on, and that's because with the reorganization into landships and so on, there's now a lot of missing translation keys. That needs fixing up. So that's all the fixes. Then we've got kind of, and yeah, all the other things is basically sound and graphics. So we're going to work on the fixes for a while, and then I'm going to take a break, and then we're going to do some graphic stuff. So fixes. Let's do the AI stuff, right? So let's just see what happens if you actually have some AI landships. Let's see how badly they misbehave. Water. So you might know Stuff Plus. He is a YouTuber who has been covering airships for quite a long time now, and he has this like whole beverage based thing in his stream, which has probably made me think of what the streamer drinks as being a more important element to streaming than it actually is. Right. We're going to do start with something easy. Just want to see, okay, there's no trees in the way, the terrain's a bit rugged, but whatever. So let's just put some landships. Here to the right. And like, we'll have a landship here too. Let's see what the AI actually does. Okay, so far so good. They're a bit enthusiastic, re-jumping, but they're moving forwards. Okay, they're even leaping across one another with profound enthusiasm. Okay, so they're a bit collide-y. Okay, they're fairly collide-y. That's a bit bad. Okay, so all in all, it's not bad. The main problem is that they get... Ooh, wow. To get very enthusiastic about colliding. But, you know. Okay, so the main problem is that clearly ship on ship collision avoidance is broken. And the reason for that is likely that their little brains are going, we're going to fly somewhere up there where we have an optimal firing. And then they don't realize that what they're actually going to do is walk across and slam straight into an enemy ship. So this problem might just get fixed if we actually make them track their exposition. So I am LAM518. Yeah, I think a lot of people, like a large chunk of the player base, know the game because of Stuff Plus, basically. I genuinely think that probably about a quarter of all Airships players know about it because of him, which is really awesome. Right, so let's go into tactical AI, which is the brains of the whole thing. And so the way tactical AI basically works is, what kind of AI do I use? I use, well, what's the technical term for this? It's a kind of, I think there's a like sensible technical term for it, but basically what it does is that it builds a map of the play area and assigns each point in the map a quality score. And a quality score, it basically calculates from how well can I hit enemies from here, how well can enemies hit me from here, those are like the major ones, and then, oh yeah, obviously I can actually get there, like is it within my service ceiling, and then also stuff like, and then like can I get there without like flying through a solid block of floating rock or another airship or something. And then there's some additional heuristics, basically if all on balance it prefers being higher up, and on balance it also prefers locations which have less stuff around them. So the idea is that if it's like, if the ship's sort of boxed in by floating rocks, it's actually pretty good at getting out of being boxed in, because it will fly around them by basically greedily looking for new locations that are less boxed in. So it can actually kind of, well, it can't exactly run mazes, but it can, like, if it's like boxed in on the top and from the left and from the right, it's smart enough to go down and then to the side and then up. That's about the extent of it, and that's kind of enough. And yeah, so everything that we're really doing here is we're basically calculating the values that we stuff into this grid array. So this is a three-dimensional array of y-coordinate, x-coordinate, and are we looking left or are we looking right? And the AI constantly recalculates this grid, and then when it's time for it to take a decision, it looks at those grid tiles and sees, oh, if there's a grid tile that has a significantly higher value than the value of where it currently is, then it flies over there, basically. And then the shooting's handled separately. It's almost a kind of a, it's like a cut left brain, right brain type thing, almost. Like, the movement code is aware of the idea that shooting happens and positions the ship in a way that shooting works, but it doesn't actually drive the shooting. The shooting just sort of happens, which is kind of how you control it as well. Anyway, so if it's a land ship, then we can be much simpler here. Okay, so grid V size is, so if the ship is immobile, then it's zero, because hey, who cares, you know, it can't move, so why create this whole data structure? And otherwise it's basically enough tiles to deal with the ship's service ceiling. But now we have to complicate this logic a little bit more. We also have to say if ship.type dot on ground, then it's exactly one high. So, because, I mean, it can only move horizontally, and so we only need one tile per. Okay. So that pretty much works in the basics, but now, of course, the Y coordinate that each of these tiles refers to is going to be different, because right now, if it just left it like that, it would just look at some kind of weird place right at the top of everything, which isn't really going to be the right thing to do. So we now have to go to the piece of code that takes the Y index in the grid and converts it to an actual value in the coordinate system and make that one better. And conveniently, the very next value is grid Y anchor, which is basically saying, well, where and Y position does this grid start? So anything that uses that is going to do this conversion, which we have to improve. There we go. So basically, there's four places, two in the actual AI and two in the AI debug layer, which I can show you in a moment. Actually, it's quite fun, which actually draws this map onto the screen. So what we want to do here is to have a new function, which is something like public double get world y from grid y int grid y if ship dot on. We do something, we'll get to that in a moment. And otherwise, we'll do that. We just do return grid y anchor plus grid y times grid step. So that's the case for airships. And here for ground ships, it's a bit more difficult because you actually also need to know where everything is. So that thing is going to need to have a combat passed in. And if it has this, then it can go say something sensible. Which is basically this thing we were doing earlier, which was the place ship tool again. Basically the value. So we asked the ground, give me the vertical position of the ship on the basis of okay, so that works. So what it does is it asks, no comments in the code at all. There are comments in some of the places of the code. So there's a whole bunch of different philosophies about how much commenting you should do. I generally adhere to the idea that comments that state things that are already visible in the code are bad because they're just gonna get out of sync with the actual code. So places where I do put comments are anywhere where there's a gotcha. So anywhere where it's like this has to be like this because of this other consideration which you can't see. Places where like mathematical formulas, this code looks like this because of this bit of algebra. But when it just comes to say something like this, to my brain this is fairly readable as go to the combat, ask for the first land formation, which is the ground, then ask it for the vertical position of this ship, add the X position, which is here, and then subtract the ground offset to get the vertical position. So to my mind, this is readable. But yeah, I mean, obviously this project, I'm the only developer. I'm always going to be the only developer. So yeah, it sort of doesn't matter that you have to be me to understand the code. Like one of the questions that's come up, for example, is am I planning to port this to like tablets or consoles and something? And the answer is basically no, because it's a really user interface heavy strategy game, and I think it would be painful to play on a tablet or on a console. Could just about see it working in an iPad with some wincing. But anything else, not really. The next project, which I'll likely be working on in like 2016, it's going to be kind of a different game, and there I'm probably going to use Unity, and a slightly different development methodologies as well, because with that one I think it actually will work really well on the console, will work really well on the tablet, and so on. So the code there might actually be seen by other people. Okay, so we've got get world y from grid y, and now we should actually use this, like here, which means you need to pass in the combat in here. Which then proceeds to make this catch fire. Oh, we didn't have to pass it in, because actually we hold a reference to the combat. In this object. Convenient. Okay, and then fails horribly here. For some reason. Because you don't need... Right. Okay. Then the other place is calculate row, which is here. Okay, so it's complaining because it's a double. Can't really do much about that. It is technically a double, so just make it an int. Oh, and the other thing that's a bit awful is that the arguments here are in a non-standard order, so let's fix that. Now, of course, we need to go back to places where we, to two places where we called it, and actually fix that as well. One of my long-standing niggles is, if you have some kind of grid-based data structure, the first index is y and the second index is x. The reason you do it that way is that it's much faster to scan through it like that. So I'm always semi-tempted to just have a rule throughout the code that you specify coordinates in reverse order, so z, y, x, and I can never actually do this because, of course, the libraries I talk to don't believe in this. So I can't do it all throughout because the libraries still want x, y, z. So I end up doing x and y and reversing it in the loops and hoping usually it works. Okay, so we've got this, we've got calculate row, we calculate the value for our particular x coordinate, and technically speaking, this now pretty much works. Let's see what happens. Oh, we haven't fixed it up yet in the debug layer. again. Let's go for so. Okay, so now what I would like to see in an ideal world is the enemy ships not constantly colliding with each other. So far so good. Yeah, see, this is the problem. They just get really, really enthusiastic. And then this happens. Okay, so they're too amorous, right? And we need to fix that. So the interesting question is, why isn't it why isn't it clever enough to realize this turret's going to collide with the friendly ship? So one thing which we can try is we can make our virtual collision size bigger for purposes of the collision testing, which might fix it. So we've got low Y and high Y. So high Y is the highest Y coordinate which we expect to be ending up in during this move we've planned. And in the case of a land ship, we're just going to set that to basically infinity, which means that they will consider everything below them to be part of their potential collision area, which might stop them trying to scramble over other ships. Oh yeah, okay, so what might be happening is that the land ship is going, I'm on this peak, I want to go over to that peak. My friend is down there, but that's okay, I won't collide with him because I can totally just fly from peak to peak, right? Then what happens is actually it can't fly, it goes down and it smashes into the other ship. Okay, so ship dot type dot on ground question mark, just set it to 1000. There we go. No, actually, there we go. Okay, let's try that again. Let's see if that fixes its behaviors. Oh. Actually, before we do that, I just want to also fix it in the debug layer. Go. And let's just make sure that the AI debug layer is actually available. It is technically, so theoretically speaking, we can switch it on by hitting 0. Let's see if that actually works though. It's been a while since I used the AI debug layer, so maybe it's a bit rotted away, but let's see. See, I'm just looking for ones without trees, because we're going to look into the whole thing of does it at all deal properly with trees later. Right now I just want them behaving sensibly in fairly straightforward situations. Okay, so if we hit 0, there we go. How did I end up building this madness, asks Nicolau. Which madness in particular, the code or? Okay, so here you can see now each of these little blobs represents one of the ship's ideas of what what locations are viable. And they've both decided to go all the way back there, I believe. Yeah, if I hit 2, I think I'm cycling through the ships. So they basically have the same idea. Speeding things up. So yeah, the problem is to still do this, right? Turn it back on again. Watch me not remember what these buttons do. Okay, yeah. Not the foggiest what these buttons should do. So the one at the back has now decided to start moving again. But that's bad, because now he's just Ramsay's friend. Okay, how did I end up building the whole project overall? So, back in September 2013, I started making this kind of airship building combat prototype. Actually, at the time, I was mostly trying to blow off some steam because it had some interesting legal trouble, known as not getting paid for a lot of work I did. And so, yeah, I started working on this, started blogging about it, and people were very encouraging in the blog, so I just sort of kept on working on it. And now here we are, nearly almost 2 years later now, and it's on Steam, it sort of works, and it's pretty nice, actually. Okay, if I hit 6 enough, maybe something will happen. But yeah, I'm a bit disappointed, because evidently the ships aren't smart enough yet to understand that maybe they shouldn't just smash into each other. Just sort of weird. Also, I've noticed that so all the blobs you saw that were red, which actually sort of indicates that they're unhappy with all the possible positions. Oh god, okay, so what's actually happening is that the AI is... Okay, so What we're actually seeing is that the AI is completely broken. It's evaluating all possible positions, and it's considering all possible positions to be invalid. And it freaks out because it literally can't find anywhere to go. And I think just defaults to going to the lowest X coordinate they can think of. And that's why they just walk from right to left, which happens to be the right behavior for a landship, more or less. But it's not actually doing anything smart. How come every third code had problems getting paid like normal people? God, I wish I knew. In my case, basically, I landed the job consulting at a tech startup, and the tech startup kind of crashed and burned. And yeah, I think the rep ops need to be higher up for this calculation to work. So the job crashed and burned, and like the fact that it was kind of crashing and burning was basically kept from me. And so by the time I realized that the whole thing was failing horribly, I'd been doing like work for them for about 3 months, which they couldn't actually pay me for because they had no money, or well, they claimed they had no money. And I've been chasing them through the courts here in Switzerland for the past 2 years now, and we're just about at a point where I might actually get my money back, which is really fun. But yeah, so it can take you 2 years for going through every single bureaucratic detail, every flavor of court and arbitration and whatnot, until they finally kind of give in and pay you. Okay, so yeah, again, so yeah, this is the coordinates it's considering. And yeah, they're all red, so that means they're all at no, this isn't valid, this isn't valid, this isn't valid. So yeah. And I think part of the reason for this is what I put in here, because of course it's also using this to consider collisions with the ground and stuff. So it's pretty much just going, no, this doesn't work, this doesn't work. So let's just take this out for now. And see what it works like normally. Yeah, I'm never really sure how much I'm allowed to say about this whole like fiasco. From my point of view, which country? This is Switzerland. Basically took forever, and it was sort of expensive to do. But I have to say, on the plus side, if you are owed money by some kind of company or individual or something, there are coherent legal ways of kind of going through stuff. And one of the nice things is the state sort of does it for you. Like, you don't have to like necessarily go to some kind of collections agency or something. You have a kind of state collections concept called Betreibung, where you say like, dear government, these people owe me money. And then they go, okay, right, we'll send them a letter. And then they invite you to this kind of arbitration where you can have a little chat about it. And if the arbitration fails, then you can take them to court, and then the court looks at all the documents and decides whether or not that's actually valid. And if it's valid, then you can if it's a company or person, I guess you can technically actually apply to have them declare bankrupt if they don't pay up. And I mean, this is all very generic. I mean, this is just how it works. And in my situation, I'm now basically at this final step where the bankruptcy of the people who owe me money is actually happening. I'm not naming any names here. But yeah. Yeah, I mean, the naming names is exactly the thing which is difficult, right? Depending on your exact jurisdiction and whatnot, saying something like, oh, X didn't pay me, it could be liable. I mean, it's not liable in any meaningful sense, by any meaningful standard, but you must still get sued for it. And like, for example, in the UK, where libel laws are completely insane, that might be bad enough. Okay, so yeah, so they're still all red. It's basically saying, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just gonna like cry over in the left corner. So what we need to do is we need to futz around with stuff until some of these little rectangles actually turn like a whitish, greyish, blackish color. Something that's not just no. I'm going to have to look into what the problem here is. So calculate normally. Gets its Y position. From calculate. Gets its Y position from here. Okay, so let's start out by just going, dear code, are you actually even calling calculate normally? Okay, yeah, sounds pretty much like in Finland. Yeah, probably similar system. So, like, this isn't something that necessarily that many English-speaking people from the actual English-speaking world are aware of, I don't know. There's kind of two major legal systems, so to speak, in the Western world. There's the Napoleonic code system, and there's the kind of Anglo-Saxon common law type system. And they work kind of differently in the sense that basically the Anglo-Saxon system is very much based around precedent, whereas the Napoleonic system is based more around laws and regulations. And so one of the nice things, I personally think the Napoleonic system is vastly superior, because one of the nice things there is you can, like a contract under the Napoleonic system, even for like an employment or something like that, can be like two sentences. Because you can just say, this is a contract of employment, we're paying Bob this amount of money. And because there's laws that indicate what the contract of employment actually is, that's enough. It's like an import statement in code. You just import, you know, the headers for employment contracts, and then you just fill in the relevant bits. Whereas the like Anglo-Saxon legal kind of concept of contracts, you basically recreate the entire concept of an employment contract each time you want to make one. And then you have a vast quantity of precedent and rulings and stuff that sort of dictates whether or not the contract you made is legal, how it gets interpreted, and so on and so on. And it basically means you get a lot of work for lawyers, and the contracts are completely unreadable for laymen. So it's quite nice having a Napoleonic system, because you need it kind of slightly for your lawyers. Okay, so let's see what happens now, if anything. Nope, they're all red. Well, we knew that, but okay, so it just keeps on saying CN no, CN no, CN no. So This is failing. What's ask? Clearly, whatever ask is really harshing our mellow here. Available server ceiling, right. And it's a LAN chip, it doesn't have anything. Okay. Right, so the reason why it's failing is that it's actually looking at the service ceiling of the ship and going, well, wait a moment, that's like zero. It can't possibly go anywhere. And that's why it's failing. So if this is only relevant if not ship.type.onGround. Right, now let's just look at this ask value, see if it's being used somewhere else. Because of course anywhere it gets used, it's going to really mess up our calculations. But it looks like we're mostly just using it there. Okay, so that's one obstacle done. Might be that now some of these values are non-read. I'm just going to make a note here. If all grid values are no, ship goes to left side of screen. I've actually seen that happen previously in like combat situations where the ship would just suddenly go bonkers and just go to the left side of the screen. And yeah, I think that just happens when it can literally not find any coordinate to fly to. So let's see what happens. Look. It's no longer completely useless. It now works kind of correctly. So now each of these little pills you see here is like, it's that XY coordinate, and the left part of it is okay, this is a bit bad really. The left part of it is if it was facing to the right, and the right part is if it was facing to the left. So it's saying, well, facing to the right would be really stupid or in all of those locations, because it would involve facing away from the enemy. Whereas facing to the left, now that sounds delish, because then we can shoot the enemy. Now I can adjust the kind of intensity here a bit, and there we go. So now you can see these are sort of dark grey, because it's too far away, and it gets zooming in so you can actually see it. So all the way back here, they're pretty dark, and that's because it's too far away to actually aim properly. Then if we move closer, they get lighter. And then finally, you know, we move closer yet, and we're also higher up. Then finally, this is, it wants to be here. It wants to stand on this tree. Good luck. Because if it were to stand on this tree, it would be really close, and hence be able to shoot the enemy. It would also be further up, and hence be able to shoot the enemy accurately. So that's what it wants. And then all of these areas are red because it realized it can't move past there. And indeed, there we go, it now targets this location. So if we make time and move forwards, you can see it's okay, it got temporarily stuck. Now it's trying, okay, can't get past that tree, but it's at least standing there. Yeah, to no one's great surprise, trees are a bit of a source of confusion for this poor thing. It's still trying to get past the tree, but it can't. Oops. Because every time it tries, it sort of has its movement cancelled by the collision detection, I think. So that could show us how to be a bit better. And we can look into that. Now, of course, it's happy because, well, it doesn't want to move any further to the left anyway. So if we move away again, we can see it's updating these. It would like to move further to the left, just a green thing we can't quite manage. So it gets sad. Okay, so it'd be great if it didn't do that, but at least that's a whole lot better now. Okay, so how can we make it behave better yet? So the reason why it's not moving left, I can think of one of two possible reasons. One is it's going, well, I can't move there because my movement would be colliding with this tree. And the other one is, well, I can't move there because my movement would be I'm trying to move there, but every time I try to move there, the collision detection kicks in. But I feel like we've already dealt with the collision detection, not looking at squishy bits. So my thesis is now that it's sad because it it thinks it will get stuck. Should really be in here as it loops over the land formations. Might be that. So this is very simplistic, because it's literally just looking at the total shape of the land formations. It's just on by default, just flag. Yes. Yes, it really is. Let's turn it off. I think we can even do that from the settings somewhere, but just said turn it off here. How do we turn this off? 7. Okay, so we can try toggling the 7 key and turning off it dealing with land formations, and then maybe it won't get stuck against the ground at all. Should be nice. How long has it been? Okay, I started the stream at 11:30. Now it's nearly 1 o'clock, so I'm going to do until 1 o'clock sharp and then take a break. And I will let you know back on the stream with like half an hour's notice or something when it resumes. Okay, so something with some trees. Actually, let's take one with a flamer. We're really motivated to go left, because if it doesn't, it can't shoot me at all. Because it's pretty sad about all of these locations. Now it's a bit less sad. Okay, so it's just stuck against. Oh no. It's doing its best to try and destroy that tree. But now it's stuck. It's literally just pushing against that tree and getting nowhere. So if we hit 7, that doesn't do anything. Okay, so you can see there's a slight difference here, because depending on whether we make it aware of land formations, it considers, I think, this floating rock here. But that doesn't really make it capable of dealing with the core problem, that it's just going against a piece of rock, against this tree stump. Okay, so it's, you know, it works less badly now. It's no longer completely and utterly broken, but we're still having some issues. Like, what it should probably do is just walk back and try again. That's what I would do. Or move in RAM mode for that little distance, or something like that. I'm gonna go away and think a bit about what the best way might be for smaller land ships to deal with there being trees in the way. Yeah, so I'm gonna close up the stream here for now. But as I said, I will be back in a few hours with more streaming. Probably that time I'm going to be doing graphics. So I'm going to finally do the interiors of the kind of foot modules. I'm going to do the tracks and so on. I'm going to do all of these graphics that are still missing. So if you want to see some pixeling and some graphics programming, do tune in later. And for now, well, thank you very much for watching, and I will see you in the future.